Hello? Hello? Can I have your attention, please?
No, it's a hereditary thing. I don't have it, too.
How are you?
Thank you.
Good, good. So welcome to the AA. Tonight I have the privilege of introducing Paul Shepheard, who is our lecturer. Before we get to sort of the good part of tonight, I have to do one practical thing. If you can please take your mobile phones and turn them off so we don't get any frequency issues, we would appreciate that. Tonight, we have, as I said, Paul Shepheard, who is an architect and a writer. He has studied here in this place, the AA. He also has taught here, amongst other places, Artesis in Antwerp, Belgium, the Amsterdam Academy of Architecture in the Netherlands, the University of Texas in Austin in the US, University of Queensland in Australia, and as well as in London and Westminster and Kingston. But he has written a collection of books that revolve around trying to make sense of this thing that we call architecture. The first book sort of in this series was called quite directly, What is Architecture? Resulting in sort of three themes from landscape, machines, and buildings. The first in the series was A Cultivated Wilderness, which was about landscape. The second was Artificial Love, which was about machines. And the third, which is why we're here this evening, is Buildings Between Living Time and a Rocky Place. This book, which is here, is available in the back doorway for purchase, which I can highly recommend. When I first picked up this book, I assumed it was just another typical book about architecture and theory and on building and maybe what the difference is, but I was very wrong. I'm pretty sure it's the first and only book on architecture that starts out with a poor rabbit being mutilated by a fox in all graphic detail of having its ears ripped off. But this entry to the book had me sort of hooked with its refreshing approach to architectural writing. Part memoir, part personal anecdote. At one point, Paul states, whether it's Albert Einstein or the tea lady, a conversation has the potential spark to light a million fires. So he uses these sorts of conversations from different events throughout his life, conversations with his children, with an artist in the north, with friends and strangers, to put forward a series of observations and thoughts about buildings and what defines them. Paul is a writer, but he also states in the book that writers are makers, and I couldn't agree more. So with that, I'd like to pass over the microphone to Paul, and please welcome him to the AA. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Nice to see you all here, it really is. A little while ago, I had a morning on my own in the house. Nothing to do, no work to do, nothing. Just a few hours on my own in the house. And I was wandering around the place, and I started to notice things, like how high the handrail was on the stairs, and how the end of the stairs came round to welcome me in, and how far it was to the front door, and how you could see the garden from the front door, and all these things. And I was thinking, I'm using this house. I'm thinking about using this house. And then I thought, use is a kind of criticism, isn't it? And then I thought, and criticism is a kind of use. And that was one ambition with this book, to write about buildings. I'm a bit put off by this feedback. Is this too close to my face? It's the other mic. Good friend, well done. If I stand over here, it won't happen. Where was I? Yes, criticism is use. And that was one of my ambitions for writing this book. I wanted to write about buildings, but not analytically critically, not culturally critically, not trying to put things right critically, but just as a user. And the other ambition I had was to write about every building in the world. I wanted to write about all the buildings in the world, which is hard to do. I think we, I've got to go over here to get the first slide. Can we turn these mics off, Fiona? Oh, it's the cover of the book. This book has two titles. One is Buildings, and the other is Between Living Time and Rocky Space. And the more I think about it, I think Between Living Time and Rocky Space could have been the title of the book. But the Buildings is to make the point that it's the last in the quartet. The What is Architecture started out by describing architecture with the strategies of landscape and the tactics of buildings and the operation of machines, landscapes, buildings, and machines. And I wrote the landscapes book fairly soon after What is Architecture, and I wrote the machines book maybe 5 or 6 years after that. And now this is 22 years on, and I've got around to the Buildings book. And I didn't want to do a Buildings book. When I came to it, now I've got to do Buildings. I didn't want to do it because I didn't really like buildings by this stage. I'd become a writer, and there was something about buildings which really annoyed me, the way they just stand there, indifferent to everything you think about them. You know, so I went off and had a holiday from the quartet and wrote How to Like Everything. And then I thought, this is stupid. How can I write a book about how to like everything and then not like buildings? So I went back. I had this idea. I'll go back and remember what it was like when I was in my gap year, when I was 19, driving across Europe, looking at cathedrals and the Renaissance and the Unité, all these powerful buildings from the past. And discovered I like buildings again after all. Now, that's the Buildings part of the title, which is easy to explain. The Between Living Time and Rocky Space is much harder to explain. And of course, if you read the book, you might figure out what it means. It's something to do with the original notion in What is Architecture, I suppose, that buildings are made out of pieces of the world. People have taken pieces of the world and hammered them about a bit to suit themselves and change them and set them up there. They're still really pieces of the world, but they've been changed to suit human needs. And as long as the humans are alive and remember why they did it, the buildings have some sort of life. And my mentors have told me that time and space are inseparable. You can't talk about one without another. Fred's told me that, Jacob in Holland has told me that. You know, it's Einsteinian space-time, and I'm not convinced, you see. I like the Einstein thing about space and matter. How does it go? Space tells matter how to move. Matter tells space how to curve. That's beautiful. I mean, if you're trying to understand gravity, that's a beautiful saying. And of course, nobody can understand gravity, but I figured out, I think, that nobody can understand gravity because we don't have any day-to-day experience of it, except for the major event of the Earth, the gravity sucking us into the Earth. It's difficult to understand that gravity accrues the bigger you get, because the biggest thing in the vicinity is the Earth, and it's too big to see. Anyway, that's the space part of it. This is the life part of it. As long as you're alive, you're living in time. And when I put these pictures up, I thought, well, there's something for everybody here, isn't there? But these pictures were taken in the 60s, 60 years ago. So she and he are both very old now, or quite possibly dead. And of course, once you're dead, not of course, but once you're dead, you enter the world of rocky space and you leave the world of living time behind, was my thought. I know that some people don't think that when you're dead, something else happens. And I'm starting to think that myself, actually. My daughter is quite convinced. And this is rocky space. I really wanted a picture of the Milky Way because that's where humans live. That's where the entire biomass lives. On Earth, near the Sun, in the bottom, one of the bottom parts, the Perseus arm of the Milky Way. And I got stuck into Google, finding Google images for this lecture. And all the pictures of the Milky Way were artists' impressions. I wanted a picture of the Milky Way. You know, why can't they got a picture of the Pinwheel Galaxy? And it really, it took me an hour or two to realize that you can't have a picture of the Milky Way because you have to be 500,000 light years away to get it all in. So there never will be a picture of the Milky Way from the outside. I don't know how you feel about that. I'm quite struck by that. But the Pinwheel Galaxy looks quite a lot like it. And here, this is one of the artist's impressions. This is a real Brian Cox of a picture, this one. Isn't that great? The Gum Nebula, the Orion Association, the Aquila Rift. And here's a building, poised between rocky space and living time. It's on the side of, on the south side of Snowdonia, Snowdon, Mount Snowdon. It was really pouring with rain. You can see how low the crowd is. I only got another 100 paces up before I had to turn around and come back. And this building is made out of the rocks that the mountain is made of, and it obviously had human habitation once upon a time. You can tell that by the windows and the doors. There's a thing very like that at Chinati, Donald Judd's place in Texas, which is just a wall like that, with a window like that and a door like that. And Judd used to sit next to this wall, and the wall was behind him, and the lights of Texas were behind the wall, and the darkness of the west was out in front of him. Nothing but stars, just stars. And he used to drink whiskey. And when the bottle was finished, he hurled it over the wall like that, and it would smash on the stone apron behind. Yes. Now, writing is about people. It's not about You can write about the material world, but you're really writing about people using the material world all the time. I think writing is about character. And one of the things that started to happen when I was writing this book was that the buildings became characters themselves. So there's no architects mentioned in this book. No architectural theory in this book, really. It's all about the buildings and using the buildings. And the end of each chapter has a little portrait, character sketch of one of these, of a building, which is about a theme. I won't tell you what they are. I will if you ask a question at the end, but now this is one of my heroes. It's my big hero, it's John Summerson. Isn't he beautiful? Look at him. And they were neighbors of ours, and I grew up with his sons, and he was a rather distant figure. When I started to write in 1986 or 7, and wanted to take it seriously, and didn't know whether I could do it, and had to find out from somebody, and none of my friends could tell me. It was really weird. I'd show them this, and they said, "This is really great." But they couldn't tell me what it was about it or anything like that, and I thought I'd go and beard Summerson in his cell, because he was pretty old by that stage. And he had Parkinson's disease, which is another reason he's a hero of mine. And I used to go and sit with him, and he used to bring out the tea tray and say, "It's all right, I'll pour the tea like this," and the tea goes splashing all over the place, which I thought was very amusing at the time. And I think I still think it's pretty amusing. So he told me I could write, which was great. And he said, "There's only one thing, Paul. All atheists are bloody fools." Because he was getting ready to meet his maker, and he was getting ready to detach and go and join the Pleroma from whence he had come. All atheists are bloody fools. And he said, the other thing is you must be very careful not to poison the wells of truth. I wasn't a youth anymore, but I was still pretty callow. And I was sitting there thinking, yeah, but how can I not be an atheist when that's what I am? I don't believe in God. And I just thought, how can I stop poisoning the wells of truth? He's really talking about speculation. Don't speculate. We always need the facts. But I speculate all the time. And so I don't know how I feel about that either. But I love this man. And his book, Heavenly Mansions, had this fabulous picture in the front as a frontispiece. And he was writing it during the war. It was published in 1949. My book actually says it was published in 1947, which is one of two mistakes I found in the book. But he was writing this during the war, and he was observing this church in Stoke Newington was blown apart by a doodlebug, a flying bomb. And he's saying how interesting it was that ordinary people in Stoke Newington could understand how buildings were put together by looking at this. Because it was fresh damage, and so all the plaster inside and the holes in the roof and everything. And this is an example of what I mean by criticism as use. It's a very generous observation to make about a difficult situation. I wonder if you recognize this staircase. It's in the Van Nelly chocolate coffee factory in Rotterdam. And it's a weird thing. It's a double staircase. You go in through the door, and there's a staircase going up, and there's another one going up. And they cross over so that although you're talking to people in the other staircase, you're never actually crossing them. And it's a gender separation. It's a men and women staircase situation, which sounds pretty 30s fascistic, doesn't it? But what's going on is that they're going to work, make processing tea and coffee and chocolate. When they get to the top of the staircase, it goes into the ablution rooms, the lavatories. So the women's one's there and the men's one's there, and they come up to the top of the stairs and they separate and they hose themselves down completely and put on sterile clothes and then go into the factory. Now, the interesting thing about the Van Nelly is that it is a fabulous building. It's got huge heft, terrific confidence. It's very, very closely designed to its function in the way I'm trying to decide with this staircase. There are many other things about it which are very closely tailored to the function of processing coffee and tea. And so it's a real form follows function building, real 30s form follows function building. And in a way, I'm sorry to be making a point about this. It's part of my understanding of my generation is that when I was a student, that's what they were telling us all the time. Ilya Zengales once told me that one of my floor plans was contrived because it didn't recognize it. So Ilya Zengales, this is before he'd met Rem, obviously. But all our teachers were talking about form follows function and modernism and not straying from the path. Well, not all of them. I can think of one who wasn't. And the huge thing is, of course, that this building, which was closely designed as the tea and chocolate and coffee factory, is no longer a tea and coffee. What's it factory? But it's being used for other uses. It's being used as design offices now. So the form is detached from the function and has found its own generosity. That staircase is a beautiful, generous thing, the way you meet people on the staircase without any purpose for meeting them. It's very interesting. I think I made that clear, haven't I? Criticism is use. Use and function, yeah. What I think is that function is what architects use to set buildings up. They think about how it's going to be used and they design around that so they know how it's going to be used. But then they go away and people come in and start using it in quite often completely different ways. So function and use, although they sound like the same thing, are not the same thing. Criticism is use, function and use, function and form. This next one is about form and perform. Bannister Fletcher and Indra McEwen, there are no architects discussed in this book at all, but Summerson and Fletcher and McEwen are. They're writers, and one other, the Japanese poet Basho. And this is a picture of, well, you can see what it's a picture of. And do you know the story? You must know the story about the Minotaur. Queen Pasiphae fell in love with a bull that had been given to her husband, the king. So they made a big wooden cow for her. She wanted to make love to this bull. She wanted to fuck the bull. So they made a wooden cow for her to sit in so that the bull could be offered to her. This is a true story. It's been written down. And the child that came from this union was the Minotaur, half bull, half man, a terrifying creature which had to be locked in a labyrinth. A labyrinth is a system of walls which is utterly, profoundly influential on whoever's in there. A labyrinth turns who's in there into a prisoner, which was the idea with the Minotaur. And I was looking at this thing and thinking, I could see where that myth of the labyrinth came from. Look at it. Look at this palace with its walls. But in the middle is this central court, which has no walls at all. It's the opposite of the labyrinth. It's a place where it's just as influential as the labyrinth on the people inside it, but the people inside it are free to perform. So when Theseus killed the Minotaur and went off with Ariadne and abandoned Ariadne on Naxos, after that they instituted a bullfight to ceremoniously remember the killing of the bull. I can see my Greek specialist friend in the audience furrowing his brow when I'm talking about this. But that's a picture of a bull dance, and I fantasize about it taking place in the central court, which is the opposite of the labyrinth, if you see what I mean. The labyrinth is all form and imposes itself. The circus is no form, but allows you to perform. So I've got these thoughts about writing about every building in the world, and the buildings are becoming characters, but I thought, I've got to marshal these in some way. I've got to thematize this thing, so I've got to get clumps of buildings that I can write about together. And I wrote about Grothendieck's theory of mathematical sheaves, which was an attempt to parcel together irreconcilable equations into groups, which he calls sheaves. And I was entranced by this and thought, you know, this sounds pretty fancy too. And I was talking to somebody about it, about how I was working on this. They weren't themes, they were sheaves, you see, with these buildings all collected up like sheaves. Do you understand what I'm talking about? And he said, yeah, but Eisenman's done sheaves. And it was like a kick in the stomach. Eisenman had already done sheaves. What was the point of doing sheaves if Eisenman had done it? And Eisenman is one of the architects mentioned in the book, but only for that reason. But I recoiled from the sheaves thing and thought, well, it's going to be themes, isn't it? Themes are arbitrary, though. Fourth writer is Basho, the haiku poet from Japan who did the long journey to the far north. Haiku is a 17-syllable poem, very precise. And there was a way of stringing these together. When a group of haiku poets got together, you would say your haiku, and then the next poet would have to say another one, which would be related to it, but not copying it. It would be somehow sensually related to the one before. And so I conceived of this plan to do a kind of relay of these, the users of these buildings, the people who are going to represent use of the building, would look at the buildings and do things, use them. And then they would talk about them, and then they would meet other people who in the next chapter would then be the main protagonists for the next theme, you see. These are the Russians on the right, doped up to the eyeballs. What is GBR? What? Great Britain. Coming a close second. Right. So the first theme is called Mimetica, and it's handled by a painter who's busy painting the sky. When she appears in the book, she's painting the sky. This is a picture of the White Horse Hill in Oxfordshire. You can just see the white horse on the left, and that's the Iron Age fort. Now, what's crucial to this image is that the sky gets darker blue as it gets towards the, as it gets higher, as you look through up into the horizon, up into the sky, there's less atmosphere than when you look across, less thickness of atmosphere. And the blue comes about from the photons cascading in from the sun and rattling about the atmospheric molecules of the atmosphere, and they glow with the radiation of blue light, very short radiation. So this painter is busy trying to paint the blue sky, and she says it's different everywhere you go. Every time you, it's the landscape artist's first job is to paint the blue sky. because it's the moment in time that you're there, and the sky you're looking at is a different sky every time you look at it. Every time you look up, it's a different sky, because it's a different bunch of photons coming in, doing their job. Jerusalem. She gets a job to paint buildings in Jerusalem. The Church of the Holy Sepulchre is the two grey domes towards the back. This is the Dome of the Rock, and this is the remains of the temple. So the three faiths, the Christianity, the Islam, and Judaism, are all represented by sort of archetypal buildings. This is a chapter about buildings which copy other buildings. So churches are all cross plans, like Jesus dying on the cross. And that's not a mosque. That's the Dome of the Rock covers this thing here, which is called the Rock of Moriah. This is the actual rock that Abraham prepared to sacrifice Isaac on this actual rock. It's the actual rock from which Muhammad took his nighttime trip to heaven. Jerusalem is full of these profoundly meaningful pieces of stone. And the churches are all like churches. The synagogues are all like synagogues. This is the Jews praying at the Western Wall, which they call the Wailing Wall. They're wailing at what's on the other side of the wall, the Holy of Holies. This is a replica of the tent that the Ark of the Covenant was bought in during Exodus from Egypt. There's a compound like this, and then there's a tent which has got two compartments, like one of those family tents. The front ones is the holy place where the books are, and the back one is the Holy of Holies where the Ark sits. And they transported this across the desert, and all synagogues follow the pattern of this. And all mosques are after the pattern of Muhammad's first mosque, which was an ordinary house in Medina, maybe. Somebody out there will know. So the synagogues, that's right. This is Silbury Hill. This is out in the West Country near Avebury. Enigmatic, enormous, truncated cone, which is made of grass. It's made of earth, and the earth has been faced with chalk, and then grass has been grown over it. There's nothing inside it. People have gone in and had a look. There's no treasure in there. There's no bones in there. There's nothing in there. What's it for, people say? I was looking at a map with Mike Gold, and he pointed out that the Silbury Hill, which is in the center of that circle of the rhomboid, that photograph was taken from the river, which is the wiggly line that goes around there. That's Avebury, the bigger ring with the dots where the stones are, and that's the avenue of the standing stones coming up on the other side of that hill, you see. They're all 100, the four hills there and the Silbury itself are all 183 meters above sea level. They're all the same height, says Mike. Isn't that interesting? And I thought, that is extremely interesting. I've got to get a photograph of this. So I went up the other side of the hill where the standing stones are. And wherever you go off track, and the police helicopters appear almost immediately and buzz around. And I went over to the top of the hill, and so I came up to the crest of the hill, and there's Silbury. And I walked down the hill until my eye height was the same height as the top of the hill behind me. You see what I mean? So the camera was at 183 meters above sea level. And it's exactly the same height as all the hills on the other side. It doesn't really explain what it's for, but it explains why it's a mound of turf and why it's faced with chalk and it's covered with turf, because it's an artificial hill. You imagine this scene full with nomadic beaker people and some kind of ceremony going on the top of that thing. And in Texas, the one on the left is one of the missions. The one on the right is the Escorial near Madrid, which is the Spanish hegemony's power base, cathedral, palace, library, all under one curtain. And these missions were sent out there because when the Spanish got to America, they discovered there were people already living there, the people we know as Native Americans. And the debate sprung up as to whether these people were animal or human. Because if they were animal, they could be used as slaves. And if they were human, they had to be turned to Jesus. And there was a big debate in the Vatican, and they decided they were human. And so the missions were set up to go and turn them to Jesus. And they looked like, you know, this is scruffy 20th century Texas. That's what Texas looks like. And these things are like the 16th, 17th century standing in the middle of this jungle of tat. Replicas of the Escorial. There's another replica, that's the one of the princess's castles, I can never remember. It's Anaheim, so I guess it's Aurora's castle, is it? And the one in Paris is, I guess, Beauty and the Beast castle, Beauty's castle. You should know your Disney princesses. So I was once playing in the park with Felix, and he had these Transformers and Power Rangers, and we were playing in the park, and this guy came up to me and said, God, you're so lucky. He says, I've got two girls at home, and all we got is Barbie dolls. But it's a replica of that, and that is a replica of a medieval castle. There's a double replica thing going on there. The one on the right is Neuschwanstein, Mad King Ludwig in Bavaria. And the Shinto shrines that I see in Japan are never more than 20 years old. It's been going on since 700 AD, but every 20 years they strike the building and knock it down and build another one next to it. In fact, I think they build that one first and then knock that one down and then inhabit the adjacent site. It's like this. The site on the left is waiting for everything to be reproduced on the site on the right, and then it'll be transferred every 20 years. And I think they do this generationally, and it's been going on for ages, but when you're 40 or 50, you teach a 20 or 30-year-old to build it. When they grow up and become 40 or 50, they teach the next generation of 20 or 30-year-olds to do it, and so it continues. The living continues, and this is a new one. And here's a couple of pictures. These are pictures from the book there. The originals are 10 centimeters square. I wanted to prove I could still draw, you know. I wanted to prove that I could do fine drawing. So there's the temple on the right, the shrine on the left, and the square mile, which is the next one. After Mimetica, the painter, well, it's difficult to describe it just in sequence, but the painter is flown around the world by this guy who's a pilot. The pilot meets a woman who works in the square mile and opens up a chapter which is about money. This is the banker's nest of the square mile. You know, the Greater London Plan of 1944 was full of common sense of roads, circulation, industrial zoning, green lungs. The present London plan is a picturesque piece. It's arranged London, and it's responding to land value by organizing clumps of buildings so that all the tall buildings go together like this. And it's picturesque because they're all done so that they don't interrupt the view of St. Paul's, because St. Paul's is the guarantee for the City of London. The City of London's been rich for 2,000 years, still is. And they call this central district the CZA. Everywhere else in the world, it's called the CBD, the Central Business District. But because they're not actually doing business here, they're just growing capital, they call it the Central Zone of Activity. But it's very pretty at night. This is an even better example of the same thing. This is Doha in Qatar. And it's very difficult to say what those buildings are. I mean, how they came about. I think it's something to do with debt, you know? The thing about cathedrals is there's no debt structure put in place for cathedrals, so you have to build them bit by bit. You have to get money together from donations and taxes. And when you've got a chunk together, you say, okay, we'll build another bay. This takes 20 years to do. And then you get old and you go away and the next generation comes up. And by then they've collected another chunk of money and can build a bit more. And so the thing gradually grows over 200 years in rich complexity, whereas these buildings are dropped in one place, in one go, and the money is all organized differently. And that's why they look like that. I can't think of any other reason why they should look like that. I can't even think what they look like. But maybe that's too critical. The paradigm is New York. Do you know John McPhee's book about New York, where he makes this observation that cities all over the world look like they do because the New Yorkers invented this way of representing land value with towers. And so every other city of the world has a center full of towers because that's how you deal with land value. But the towers themselves, the original New York towers, these are Depression era buildings. Chrysler Building, I think, was built in 31 or 32. And it has this extraordinary totemic decoration to it. And you can obviously climb out of a hatch in the roof of this thing. If you're brave enough, you can light a cigarette up there. I don't see. Maybe that's what Zippos are for. Stay alight in the gale. So I started thinking about totems and totem poles and why they're different from other things. Why they're different from heraldry was one of the things that occurred to me. That the totems are, the spirits come from the forest, and you perceive these spirits and you turn them into the totems. Heraldry is a different sort of thing altogether, where you're it's a coded thing, where you're signifying to other people what you think. The totems are mysterious, and the heraldry has this beautiful system of the field and the charges and the ordinaries, which is like a landscape, really. And I was thinking also that this camouflage is the third one of that series. What do you think of that? The Germans have always had this very interesting way with camouflage. You know, Gertrude Stein remarked on seeing German camouflage in the First World War, that it proves that there's a different national vision for every nationality, if that's what they call camouflage. And I can't think where this one comes from, but you see how the heraldic motifs, the lion on the tail and the little German flag and the Iron Cross, are supposed to be highly visible signifiers of the thing, but the camouflage is supposed to take the vision down. And camouflage slowly became more and more interesting about buildings for the reasons listed at the bottom there, that they are superficial. They're like the style of a building. But they have a job to do, you know, they're technical. And they also have meaning. They have totemic meaning. The thing on the right is a piece of a SS camouflage. You know, the Nazis used to have this thing where they went to the forests and sat in circles and built little concrete theaters out there so that they could be Teutonic together and evoke the ancient myths. And the SS designed these camouflages to work in those forests. This one is oak pattern, I think, so that you, why would you not want to be seen in that circumstance? It's there in the army, they're the army, they need a camouflage. The last time this camouflage was used was by Arab units fighting against Israel in the Six-Day War. The camouflage is useless in the desert. It's a Northern European oak tree pattern, but it's useful as an insult, which is why they wore it. That's what I mean by totemic. The section on military buildings had to be there because the military buildings are just so interesting. You know, they're so functional and so obsessed with their utility. These are the hangars that you keep planes like the last slide in. And they look like Nissen huts, but they're made of concrete. Concrete is this thick, and it's full of reinforcing bars. They're stout buggers. They'll be there forever. And the thing about reinforced concrete is it's really difficult to smash up. You know, you can have a jolly good try, but the buildings stay there with their floors hanging off the reinforcement. This guy's having a meditative moment, I reckon. This is in Aleppo. And he's thinking, there is something that we could do to stop this siege and save the lives of the 200,000 people trapped in us. We could surrender. But it's a bit of a, I mean, Summerson's picture of the church taken out by a doodlebug is a, the same thing but different, I think you'll agree. So anyway, I was invited to give a lecture on public space to the students at the Royal College of Art who were doing a project on public space. And I thought I'd talk to them about Rome because that's full of public space. And the thing that struck me about Rome when I was there was how open to the air everything is. You know, you go in the Colosseum, it's open to the sky. And then the Victor Emmanuel Monument in the middle, that big white lump in the middle, is just a big thing that you climb up the outside of. It's all staircase leading to something at the top. And then the round thing with a hole in the top is the Pantheon, you know, which is open to the sky and lets the shaft of sunlight in. And just off the picture there is the Trevi Fountain where you can gamble in the water. And it's full of these buildings which are full of open space. And near the Trevi Fountain is the Spanish Steps. Look at that. Which is a three-dimensional piazza. Because it's a staircase, but it's generous so that people can sit around and just dwell there. I've got a picture of this taken more recently of people using it as a piazza. So this moment, one of the students raises a question from the back. I'm talking about public spaces. So this all seems very old-fashioned. And I thought, my God, what have I said? And, you know, it's happened. This postmodern everything thing that I've got is not understandable. It's old-fashioned. What they want is simple answers. They're 22. They want answers. You know everything. Give us some answers. You know that thing. So I was very taken aback by this. And, you know, she was quite nice about it and let me down gently. But still, I had been called old-fashioned. And I was smarting. And I couldn't think what was going on. Lecture about public space, Spanish Steps. The two things go together. So I was looking at this picture again, and I realized this must have been taken in, what, 2006, maybe, at the latest, 2005? No one's got a phone. And what these students of the RCA are doing is sitting around thinking, there is no public space anymore. It's all here. I can talk to people in Los Angeles, Hong Kong, at the next table, just all on my phone. Public space has dissolved and gone somewhere else. Now, I don't know what you think about that. What I thought about it was this. It reminded me of this. You know this phenomenon of the enormous swarms? Look at this one. I can't believe it's not photoshopped. But this purports to be a picture of a swarm of starlings. And Michel Serres, or was it Deleuze, said, how they do it is you fly along. You're a starling. You fly along. You keep an eye on the one in front of you, and the one behind you, and the one above you, and the one below you, and the one to the right and the one to the left. And you do what they do. It's as simple as that. And so you get these huge things. And I was thinking about these phones and how everybody is arranging themselves into these swarms, which I'm analogizing as being like this. And that this is not public space, this is public time. Time, living time, rocky space. Public space is still buildings. But this other thing, this phone thing, is public time, and it's a different thing, and it may or may not be architecture. I don't think it's buildings, but it may or may not be architecture. Okay, public space, public time. I don't suppose there's anybody here from that RCA audience, is there? Well, they wouldn't come to somebody who gives old-fashioned lectures. So this is the other one of my heroes. I've got John Summerson and I've got William Blake. lovely pencil drawing by John Linnell, who gave him his last job, you know, when everybody had turned him down and had cut him dead and left him penniless and angry in his old age. What he was angry about was Joshua Reynolds, who'd started the Royal Academy. And the Academy was a system of knowledge that would encompass the world. It was an extremely rational endeavor, and Blake hated it. He was a spiritual guy, and he hated it. He said it was poison for people to be related to this academy. And you know, there are times when I've been in academies and I've had the same thought myself, which I think may be why he's a hero. This is a Blake on the left, the sun rising, and Lady Diddley What's It on the right by Reynolds. I thought, I wonder if there's a picture by Reynolds of Blake, wouldn't that be good? Or a picture by Blake of Reynolds. And I Googled Blake and Reynolds and I got Blake Lively and Ryan Reynolds, Hollywood couple. So, you know, I enjoyed being at the AA a lot, but the AA wasn't like an academy. Alvin invented this thing. I've realized what it was. He invented this thing, because in academies you get groups of people who hate each other, and they form their fiefdoms and their alliances, and they just hate each other, and they go to faculty meetings and they all hate each other. And Alvin decided to separate everybody off into units, so it didn't matter whether we hated each other or not, because there was nowhere for the hatred to go. So it was really quite a pleasant place to work, I think, and not at all academic-like. It didn't have this poisonous academic thing about it. But when I went to Artesis in Belgium, there was a bit of poison about, and I was only there, you know, on brief visits, and it didn't really matter, but I was trying to get them to fund How to Like Everything. You know, and I had to persuade them I could write books, so I took Cultivated Wilderness along. Look, I've had this published by MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. Oh, so good, okay. So he picks up the book and he looks at it. We're out at dinner at a restaurant, the history person, the head of school, me and my friend. And he looks at Cultivated Wilderness, he said, there's no footnote. And this is a matter of some pride for me. You know, I hate footnotes. I hate the interruption that they make in the text. And that if ever I mention something, I always found a way of saying what it was without having to refer to a footnote. So I was pretty pleased with the fact that I got footnotes. But to him, it represented the fact that I was not an academic. Because the point about an academy is it's scientific. It's about knowledge. And you write a book and the footnotes are telling everybody where you got the ideas from and who corroborates your ideas and how your idea joins up with the whole rest of the academic world of knowledge. That's what footnotes are about. And I said, you know, we're sitting at dinner, he says, there's no footnotes. And I said, okay, look, forget it. I don't do footnotes. Let's just call it a day. And they said, no, we didn't mean that. But they did. So now I'm at Texas. I've had good times. These are all downbeat stories. Now I'm at Texas, and I got there on the strength of What is Architecture, and this is the cover of What is Architecture. It's the pyramids being overflown by a squadron of British Aerospace Hawks, because they're trying to sell them to the Saudis so they can go and bomb somebody else. And to me, this is a beautiful picture Well, the story is about Benedict, Michael Benedict, who was one of these guys who hated everybody. And the discussion on the table in this faculty meeting is, what are we going to call the new Center for Sustainability? Does the Center for Sustainability have the right ring about it? Michael turns and he looks at me and he says, Paul, you're a writer. What do you think it should be called? You know, drink from this poison chalice. And I said, well, you know, those jets are being sustained by vacuum and combustion and fuel. So they're being sustained in the air like that. The pyramids have found a way beyond sustainability where they're just so useless and big that they just survive. They've moved out of human life into rocky space and they just survive. And I think we really need a center for survivability. Center for Sustainability. So now I haven't only got Benedict as an enemy, I've got the Sustainability Center guy as an enemy. Who, you know, he spent the rest of his time writing acid reviews on Amazon about my books. And I said, you know, Stephen, you want to see what sustainability looks like? This is what it looks like. This is a zero carbon city. Nobody has any money, nobody buys anything, there's no energy consumption. Is that what you're talking about with your sustainability? And then when I was at Texas, there was a structures professor. I was just talking to my publisher, David, who was at Texas and doesn't remember this, but I do. They said, listen, children, that was the implication. Listen, there are two kinds of structures. There's compression structures, like igloos, and there's tension structures, like wigwams. And you know, this wasn't good enough because most buildings are hybrids of some sort. I mean, a cathedral is a compression building, but it has tension in the roof. So, you said you could call that a wigloo, or if you like, an igwam. But I thought further about it since then, and I think it's not so much compression and tension. It's more, there are other things involved. And one of the factors involved in keeping an igloo up is adhesion. You know, you put the ice blocks on, they melt the surfaces and then refreeze them together. And adhesion plays a strong role in buildings these days. And tension is really is about friction. It's about tightening things up tight so they don't move. Like those jets are made out of friction. And anyway, there's another thing, which is a cave, which doesn't fall into this pattern at all. This is the chamber being excavated for the Large Hadron Collider's Atlas sensor. You know, they had sensors the size of this room. They were like digital cameras the size of this room, and they're firing electrons through them and having explosions and tracing the decay patterns billions of times a second. And that's the building part of the collider. The collider part of the collider is a machine that has been diagrammatized rather nicely like this. The Atlas thing is at the bottom. There were others, Alice, LHCb, and CMS. The CMS people are the people who found the Higgs. Stop talking to everybody. Why do the CMS people stop talking to us? Because they found the Higgs. They don't want us to know. And they are investigating the structure of the world at minute scales, invisibly minute scales. And, you know, it's too obvious, isn't it? This is a mathematical proposition. The chapter's called Mathematics, and this is a mathematical proposition for investigating things at an enormous scale. It's very confusing for scientists that they have a theory of the minute, quantum theory, and they have a theory of the vast, special relativity, and the two things can't be brought together. The big Nobel is going to be given to the scientist who puts these two things together. And you can't help feeling that there must be something wrong with the way of doing it. And I've got a feeling it's the mathematics itself. It's not the world, it's an analogy of the world. It's a simulacrum of the world. And the more perfect the equations get, the more perfectly obvious it is what you're going to find when you work them out. Because the thing is set up to find certain things, and you're going to find what you're looking for. You're not going to find what you're not looking for, if you see what I mean. My daughter's heavily stuck into astrology. There's nothing I can do about it. She's making a mint out of it in America, so that's all right. But I found this picture of the Sagittarius constellation, which is a fantasy about how stars, visible stars, can be joined up to tell a story. And this is a modern perspective of the thing where all the other stars have been mapped on the picture. So it really is just a trick of perspective that these things look as though they belong together. They don't belong together. I'm not debunking astrology. I'm just saying how interesting all that is. Here's another picture of lines and stars. Things worth a detour in the Michelin Guide. It's absolutely true, you know, the 1, 2, 3 star thing really works. This is 3 star, this is Notre Dame. Notre Dame is the centerpiece of a cathedral building tour de force in northern France. If you can you see that gray star in the middle? The black dot in the middle is the Ile de Paris where the Notre Dame sits. And around it, I've traced the positions of the other big cathedrals all around. There's Rennes, Beauvais, and Amiens, and Lyon, and Soissons, and Reims, and Troyes, and Bourges, and Le Mans, Chartres, Evreux. There are 13 of them around this. When you join them up as a constellation, you get this star-shaped. And I thought, life can't get more interesting than this, but the Canterbury, Ely, Lincoln, York, and Durham line in Great Britain, it is, not the UK, is in a straight line, like a ley line. This is an attempt to make something out of the big cathedrals in Spain, which looks like a battle axe. So I was thinking about this in my gap year when I was walking around in the first chapter one of the book, when I'm learning to love buildings again. And I'm thinking these are the points of Europe, the points of Europe. And up at the top of the CIRCA Pass where the Rhone Glacier is, there's one particular point where within 10 kilometers, all these big rivers originate just on that watershed. You have to stretch truth a bit. I mean, it isn't the Danube that starts there, it's the Inn, but the Inn joins the Danube and ends up in the Black Sea, and the Ticino becomes the Po and ends up in the Adriatic, and the Rhone stays of the Rhone and ends up in Marseille, and the Rhine changes names quite a lot, but ends up in the Delta in the North Sea. So there are the points of Europe, and here are the lines of Europe. And I thought, this is a picture of Europe. It's a three-dimensional picture of Europe. Points, lines, and planes. What can I use for a plane? You remember Europe? The plane here happens to be the extent of the German pulsing in the 20th century. You could have used Napoleon there. So I was talking about this to my painter friend who paints the skies. And she says, yeah, but points are mathematical impossibility. They're infinities. They're infinitesimally small. You can't, they're not a material fact. They're a piece of the imagination, points. And the plane is not flat, it's curved. You know, it's curved, like the sphere of the world is curved. And you know why it's curved? Yeah, because gravity is pulling all the rocks and forming the sphere of the Earth. So the plane is made of gravity, and the third dimension is the center of the Earth. And what the cathedrals are is not points, they're volumes. There's a plane, okay, it's curved. There are lines, which are the rivers, that works too. But the last thing are volumes, they're compressed volumes. And the cathedrals are being sucked into the Earth by gravity, and they're fighting it with all their arches and everything. They're fighting it, that's what the compression structure does. They're profoundly compressive cathedrals. This is Bourges. It's a picture that Irene Scalbert dug out of the Courtauld Institute for his article about this same 13 cathedrals in AA files. And it's strange, but he's writing about the same subject, but he says completely different things about them. How can that be? I think it's because criticism is use. It's not anything more than that. Now, there's just a few slides left of... This is a big gravitational event. It's in Texas also. It's called Enchanted Rock. Enchanted Rock. And it's huge. This is another picture of it showing how huge it is, because you can see it's huge because of the size of the people walking up to the top of it. And it's naked in the desert, this thing, and it's a holy site. It's a Native American holy site. So, that, you know, that's enough to get it past being a building for me, because people are saying it is. a little way away is the Pedernales River. This is the Pedernales Falls in Texas, which has got these marble rocks at sort of neck point in the river, and it was filling with these beautiful pools. And there are big signs everywhere saying, don't swim in the water. And the reason you don't swim in the water is that 100 miles away, up on the high plains, a thunderstorm may have whipped up, and there'll be a flash flood making its way down the river towards the pools, and you'll just get drowned. It'll just suddenly overwhelm you and drown you, so you can't swim in the pools. And these flash floods in Texas are just astonishing. You can't imagine what the first settlers who went there must have thought about it. But the ants who live there, they live in holes in the sandy ground, and the storms come through and they wash all the sand into the holes. And so what an ant has to do is to clear out the hole. And you can see them in the middle there, the little brown things, and what they're doing is they get hold of a grain of sand, which is, I guess, about this big and pretty heavy. And they walk out of the hole and they heft it out over there, and then they go back and get another one, and their friends are coming past them all the time doing the same thing. And they built up this beautiful circle around the stone, like a primitive building, like an archaic building. It's a piece of ant architecture. And it's down there on the ground. It's only that big, and I took a photograph of it and thought, oh, that's another one over there. And the next one was different. This has got some different kind of impulse to it, where you're still doing the same thing, but you're piling the earth up in a different way. So this is even more like ant architecture, because there's some kind of preception going on there. I figured the advantage of doing it this way was that once you've finished, you can still get in and out of the hole without climbing over the mountain to get back to the hole. So this is a better idea. This one, the third one, is a worse idea. Where for some reason they dug a hole in a depression that was already there. They must have thought, this is a nice big hole, let's put our hole in it. But it just makes it impossible to clear out. So it isn't just humans who make buildings, the animals do it too. In fact, I think the whole of the biomass is engaged in this living time thing. This is a wren's nest, a male wren. Wrens are still basically gender divided between male and female, unlike the human race. And the male wren will build four or five of these things, kind of studies in nest shape, these balls of grass. Then you go out and find female wrens and show them the various things, and until she chooses one, and she settles in and upholstered it and is at home in the nest. Of course, he then goes on to find other female wrens to fill the other nests. But she's happy. And I showed this picture to some students in Australia, saying, come on now, this is beautiful, this thing, isn't it? It's the statue on the top of the Grand Palais in Paris. It's one of those statues, you make it in wood and you get 3mm copper sheet and you beat it on the shape of the wood, and then you take it off and you make a steel armature and you weld them all together and they go green in the weather, and it's just fabulous. It's like the Eiffel Tower is made this way. So the Australian student, say this is old-fashioned, he said, we don't want to hear this Eurocentric crap. We want to hear about Australia. And it may be that, you know, 49% of you are thinking exactly the same thing. We want to hear about the UK. But the reason it's there is just to remind me to quote from Latour. There was a quote, I don't know if you noticed it earlier on, with the military jets, which I forgot to talk about series and catastrophes. This is a Sloterdijk quote. Sitting, I saw him, went to see him at the Tate Gallery, and his position basically is that the modern project is an illusion, a waste of time, and there's no point in thinking about the future in that way. And somebody asked him a question, okay, so how should we think about things if we're not to think about structuring a better world. And he says, well, you live life as it used to be lived, when life was what it was and not what it could be. Life is what it is and not what it could be. You have series and catastrophes. You go along in your life, and then every so often something big happens, which might change the direction, or it might not. Latour's version of it, Latour's version of explaining the world is that the thing is ineffably complex. It's indescribably complex. There's no single theory which will describe the world. You need several structural theories to describe the complexity of the world, which is what's old-fashioned about the thing. And it's an innate postmodernism in me, I suppose, because I'm of that generation. And I think the idea that there wasn't one structure, but there were many structures, implies that things like things do have relationships to each other, but they are also themselves. I'm just remembering that I forgot to tell you about Basho's killing stone. But never mind, you can read it in the book. I'm pretty sure that's my last slide. Yes, it is. That's the lecture. Thank you. Cheers, cheers, cheers. 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 To do that opera singer thing, but I can't now, you stop.
Can we open it to questions? Does anyone have a question for Paul?
It's all right if you don't. Nobody ever asks questions at my talks. But I'd be very happy to answer. One of the things about Eisenman, who is mentioned here, I heard this story about Eisenman. I don't know if it's true. He gives a lecture, Peter Eisenman lecture tonight at 6:30. He stands up, he says, okay, any questions? Doesn't give a lecture at all. Doesn't need to, everybody's read his stuff. Fantastic. So let's pretend that's happened. Any questions?
Microphone, anyone, please?
This is where you, Ryan, say, oh, I've got a question.
Yes, I can do that.
No, don't do that.
No, let's
just wait until see if there's a question. This is House Red, in case anybody's wondering what the answer to that is. The book is on sale, I believe, through there. I'm happy to sign copies. That's not it, that's CIRCA's catalogue. CIRCA. Did you say CIRCA?
Very nice picture on the cover.
Oh, thanks, Red. I mean, yes, it's a painting of mine. And you're well known for hating my paintings, aren't you? Fred has been incredibly rude about paintings in the past. So rude, in fact, that I had to get up from the table and leave the pub. Where you go?
I've got a very simple question.
Thanks, Robin.
Is it S for Sony on the cover?
It is S for Sony, yeah.
Are you making a comment?
Well, I could be. I got to tell you the truth about this. Let's see now. Ants, Shunted Rock, Cathedrals, Stonehenge, Large Hadron Collider, Swarms. I think it's maybe the first slide. Dome of the Rock, Jerusalem, Russians, Basho. This thing in the middle is the killing stone. One of the things Basho came across in his journey through Japan was the killing stone, which was covered in a carpet of dead insects. It killed anything that went near it, and it's still there. People go to see it. He thought it was the spirit of the lady, nine-tailed dragon lady, nine-tailed fox lady, but science has proved that it's sitting on a fault line and sulfurous gases come out. This is actually a copy of an earlier picture of the Seven Wonders of the World, which was one of the chapters of the Cultivated Wilderness. And I think there is some comment going on there about the pervasiveness of machines and the close connection with living time that machines have compared to buildings, which I think are a little bit out of the loop at the moment. Maybe buildings are old-fashioned as well. They're a little bit out of the loop on being close to life. And one of the pitches of the book is that this is what the next generation could do. They could not sit around wondering about how to do utopian brutalist architecture. They could wonder about how to do buildings that are close to life again. And yeah, the Sony was that comment, really.
More questions?
What's he going to say?
Thanks. I'm not sure if this is a question, but I enjoyed your map of Europe with the three rivers. And it reminded me of something. I'm not sure if it's true, but I'll share it anyway. Someone tried to convince me that Le Corbusier had done a similar drawing of Europe when he was starting out to design the chapel at Ronchamp. And the story went that he was thinking of the roof of the chapel at Ronchamp as a kind of gigantic rainwater collecting dish, and that the site is kind of somewhere within shooting distance of where the three rivers arise. And I was kind of half expecting you to tell the same story. But have you ever heard that? Or was
no,
anybody else? I have no idea if that's actually true.
It's an apocryphal story. Somebody told you, but you don't believe them?
Yeah, I wish I'd done some research on it. I'm not a Le Corbusier scholar, but I always thought it was a lovely story, and I've just been waiting. Once
you discover this about this pitch point on... I see the Alps as a kind of gathering like this. Once you discover this point and these rivers come snaking off it, it is very moving. I think Ronchamp is over the border and on the foothills of the Doubs in France, isn't it? And all I know about Ronchamp is that it was built like an aircraft out of, you know, it has ribs and a skin, except that the ribs and the skin are all made of concrete, whereas in an airplane they're made as light as possible, and these are heavy concrete things, which are never going to fly. So it's a complicated allusion to the modern world. And there's the nun's hat thing about the roof as well. I do mention Ronchamp in the book, but it's more in the context of having seen the cathedrals and how this is a modern one. And it is a very emotional place. I did witness a little girl brought to tears by being taken inside this building. She was taken inside and she just wept, which makes it a pretty strong building. But I didn't know Corbusier had got there first with the four rivers thing. It's almost like Eisenman and the sheaves, isn't it? I suppose everybody's always got there first, haven't they? What's your name, by the way? What's your name?
Jonathan Hale.
I thought you were Jonathan Hale. You know, I recognize people by their Twitter picture.
So if in this process you've come to love buildings again, yes, no, maybe, a bit.
Yeah.
What I'm wondering is what you think about buildings in the context of so much of life around the planet being based on screens, that we have these structures that we go into, but we go from a screen in our home and we travel however many hours each day to another building where we confronted, mm-hmm. We spend our time with a screen-based life.
A TV screen.
A monitor screen. Laptop, tablet, whatever. So we have these temples for digital work. So how do you feel about the buildings that are housing us?
Well, I think the buildings couldn't care less about that. I think the buildings are just busy being buildings, and we're busy being infatuated by screens. That's what I meant about the public space lecturers, that public space is a lecture about buildings, it's not about digital networks. That would be the public time lecture. So I think it's a parallel event. And I think for years now people have been saying, how do you think information technology is going to change architecture? I remember Andris Brezin saying it at Westminster, you know, a good 15 years ago. Do you remember that, Gene? How do you think the digital technology is going to change architecture? And you think, well, probably not much, is what I think about it. I think the architecture is, the buildings are the buildings. I know they're wired differently, maybe. I don't know, is that a good enough answer?
Yeah.
Thanks, Arlene.
Further questions? No more questions. I'm sure there's more.
Well, there's more, but they're so difficult to articulate, yes, aren't they?
Question.
Oh, good friend.
Digital technology has made buildings less abstract in a way, don't you think? You know, like the, well, you know how the plan isn't the generator anymore. The plan isn't the generator anymore.
I thought that was because of a loss of faith in program. You couldn't rely on your building to change the world at all, and so the program is less important, and so what it looks like is more important. I think that's what I was saying earlier on. And I suppose the question is whether the information technology, what are we going to call this thing? We can't say social networks anymore. We can't say IT anymore, or whatever this thing is. The question is whether that's making the change to the perception that you can't solve the world. Very interesting point, Fred. I'm thinking of the guy in Aleppo with the AK-47, and it did seem a good idea at the time, but it's a failed rebellion out of millions of failed rebellions, and they can stay there and get everybody killed, or they could give up and just get themselves killed. But I suppose if you're going to get killed anyway, you might as well take everybody with you. Is that what they think? And there was a theory that the Arab Spring was put together by digital technology, wasn't there? And that ISIS Daesh does all its recruiting on the internet. But they would have found another way if that hadn't existed.
A question about space-time distinctions that you've made.
Okay.
And I wonder whether the digital age has actually made some of our public spaces and some of our cityscapes so completely alien, you know, the completely random shapes that we see plonked around new cities, and even, I'd say, London is largely being destroyed by some of these buildings that are not contextual, they are alien, and I wonder how much it is that people looking at things on screens generate these alien forms, and that's an impact of the...
Yeah.
Digital. What would you reflect?
Well, I think it's the money industry that's doing that to the buildings, and that the money industry is conveyed by screens. We all know that, but I think the screens are incidental to the idea that the buildings, especially in city centres, are about accruing capital. And so it really doesn't matter what they're like, as long as they get past the next funding meeting, which means they might have to have some kind of characteristic which will get you through the next funding meeting, which may be why they look like they do. But that picture of Doha, I think, is, do you remember it?
Yes,
yeah,
scary.
Well, I don't know if it's scary exactly, but I think it's extraordinary because you can't put your finger on how anybody would have come around to making things like that. And what they do, I remember somebody telling me about working for Will Alsop, and he comes in puffing his cigar. That's an interesting shape, turn that into a building. Okay. This is how it happened, and it did actually come out as a building. And I wonder whether that's the kind of conversation you get in funding meetings. But I think that's the money industry. I think the money is one thing. The machines, the digital machines, are another. And there's the media. Everything begins with M. All the chapter titles begin with M. The money, the media, and the machines begin with M too. And they, between them, have changed buildings significantly. And it's true, Gerard, since you mentioned it, that when I gave up designing buildings, it was really through the frustration of this indifference I was talking about, that you design the building and you put yourself into it and you get it costed and you get it built and you get it funded and you get it on site and it would start going up and you'd think, no, I should have done something else. But it's too late. The thing is just gonna go and be built like that. And you have to build this thing that you realize now is completely wrong. And some people, like Zaha Hadid, we were talking about earlier, can power through that and say, no, we're going to change everything. Everybody, nobody gets any money. We all stay up all night, we change it. Because this is the sort of thing she used to do. And you have to have that quality to be an architect, I think. You have to really be tenacious about these things. And I didn't have it. Because with writing, it's infinitely malleable. Every night, you can smooth it into some other direction. And I gave up architecture thinking, you know, if we were still building cathedrals, I'd stick with it. You know, I'd become a mason. I'd learn the handshakes. Which are, when I was researching Rheims Cathedral, the Masonic handshakes are a way of transmitting your degree. You know, you'd learn the handshake because you've been taught it by a mason, and so you really know your stuff if you can do this handshake. It isn't a secret society. It's a proof that you are worth employing on this project. And if we were still building cathedrals, I thought back then, I might stick with architecture because I loved them so much. And that kind of architecture, which is full of passion, I love so much. And everything else is just extremely interesting, not lovable. This is good. Lots of questions.
It just struck me talking about sort of making these buildings and changing them. When we look at the Issei Shrine, which is the same building built over and over again, and they don't improve it. They're not iterations. They're identical. It seems sort of quite perverse to keep building the same building, which probably has some problems.
Well, I don't know that. That's experience talking, isn't it? Every building has problems. Therefore, the icy shrines must have problems. And it may be that they are, I mean, it's a storehouse, you know? It's a rat-proof storehouse with a thatched roof. It isn't very complicated. And it's made with techniques that go back hundreds of years before they started this business. So maybe they've ironed all the problems out. What, Fred? He's talking about the temples at Issei being constructed from drawings which were done in the 20s. I'm not sure where he's going with this. Where are you going with this?
It's a footnote.
Well, maybe it's like the Masonic handshake. You know, there was a time when you had to remember how all that stuff meant. No, you didn't have to remember. It's right there. You just do it like that. You don't need a drawing. You do it like that. And at some point, somebody has put the drawings together because people are very busy and always need something to do. And maybe it's a contractual thing. There may be a health and safety reason why they have to do it that way now. But it's so associated on a drawing. It's supposed to be like this. It's been stamped by the governor. But sorry, to get back to your question,
I went to a lecture a few years ago by one of the carpenters who builds it, and there aren't any drawings, but there are templates, which are the sort of actual size paper, like a kind of dress pattern that they draw around. So
yeah, that's how they built the cathedrals too. Sorry, I'm beginning to run out of steam here, although it's been terrific to have all these questions. And it may be that it's time to draw the evening to a close. But thanks all for coming. Yes, that's all we need to say, isn't it? No further advertising necessary.